to one of our robots and said, that machine took my job, because that machine didn't. We've always gone to our customers and said, please, upgrade the individual.
What in the world are we going to retrain for? I can't imagine. We can't all be computer operators. What are you going to compute?
Ways to eat McDonald's chicken.
Revolution, one just as central to the nation's growth, the Industrial Revolution. And it had its beginnings here in the textile mills of Lowell, Massachusetts. About 150 years ago, mills such as this one heralded the new economic order in America and introduced to the nation the 19th century's most advanced ideas in power generation, industrial machinery, and mass production. As industries expanded in size and number, American manufacturers combined an abundance of raw material and cheap labor with the constant development of new machines and processes to mass produce just about everything a growing population could need, from shoes to steam locomotives. And then, just when it appeared as though the nation perhaps had reached saturation point, both in factories and their products, a second industrial revolution was triggered by the arrival of the internal combustion engine, petroleum, and a host of other new chemical processes. A revolution heightened further by men like Henry Ford, who doubled wages, cut working hours, and gave new meaning to the assembly line process. And now we're in the third industrial revolution. Some call it the high-tech revolution. High-tech for that catchphrase that has swept the imagination from Main Street to Wall Street. At the heart of this revolution, the chip.
3, 2, 1, solid motor ignition and liftoff.
The chip guided us into space.
Program initiated. Good roll. Put the Challenger in the proper attitude for
it. It is the core of the computer revolution. The robot revolution. The biotech revolution. Computerese is a whole new language descending upon us. Bits and bytes and RAMs and ROMs and floppy disks. Silicon Valley in California is part of the high-tech dream and the dream-nightmare equation. This is Hewlett-Packard, the largest electronics company in the valley, employing 70,000 workers worldwide with revenues of $4.7 billion last year. In 45 years, it has never laid off an employee. These companies employ engineers who earn more than $30,000 a year, and production workers assembling computers who may start at under $12,000 a year and average nationally around $19,000. Well below what steel and auto workers have been earning.
Now we've completed today's run. What we want to do is go through all the work centers and find out where the problems were at. Okay, station number 4.
We're having a problem with the grommets not fitting into the sweep board.
Company officials have been to Japan and brought back ideas about quality control, worker participation, the worker as part of a family. Union leaders concede they've made little progress with high-tech companies. Even low-skilled, low-paid production workers consider themselves part of a get-rich-quick generation, the instant millionaire syndrome in Silicon Valley. Workers also have seen other companies respond to union threats by moving whole plants to third-world countries where they pay as little as 75 cents an hour for this kind of work. For Hewlett-Packard workers, the imports from Tokyo even include this daily routine. Who insist the high-tech future works also point to Boeing aircraft in Seattle, a prime example, they say, of the third industrial revolution. You see the past and the future in the drafting rooms where blueprints and pencils are being rapidly replaced by computers.
Well, now, what's going on in here?
In here, Walter, is where we design the interior of the airplane, both the 767 and the 747 airplane.
Doesn't look very automated to me.
Well, it's not, Walter. In fact, we're entrenched in 65 years of designing airplanes this way, and what we've got to do is automate this manual process you see here into a computerized process.
And then that's what's happening now in moving into the computers. You're getting rid of this aspect of the business.
Slowly we're doing it. Yeah, slowly we're building that database. It's going to take all of these manual products that we've got here and put them in the computer.
Does that mean that all these people are going to be unemployed?
Oh, heavens no. Heavens no. In fact, we've not seen any decrease in manpower since we started this process. In fact, people are moving to new skills. We're training people that we've got to these new skills. And I don't expect to see a wholesale redundancy of people.
The technical term for this, one you're going to hear a lot about in the future, is computer-aided design, computer-aided manufacturing, CAD-CAM. CAD replaces a drafting board with a video screen. You design on the screen without tapping a pencil. CAM takes those designs and generates computer instructions to manufacture the parts. Want a door moved? CAD-CAM. Are the harnesses for the flight crew strong enough? The computer will tell you. Can the 747 carry the space shuttle on its back? Find out this way. We saw them put together much of a 767, all pre-tested in the computer, with 15 persons in an 8-hour shift. We speeded it up. Say this is the answer. Productivity, vastly increasing output with fewer people. They say it worked in the first and second industrial revolutions, and it will work in this one. They point to agriculture. In 1923, one farm worker supplied almost 9 persons with farm products. Today, one worker supplies 79 persons. High-tech revolution sounds fine unless you live in the Rust Bowl, those industrial towns in mid-America where a lot of jobs are gone. In jeopardy is the blue-collar middle class who bought houses, paid off mortgages, raised children, and hoped their sons would follow them into the mills and factories. And those who feel that at 45 it's too late to pick up and learn new skills. The Great Lakes states alone have lost almost 2 million factory jobs in the last decade. The obsolete steel mills are tumbling down on whole communities. ₹1,500 steelworker jobs were lost when U.S. Steel's Ambridge, Pennsylvania plant closed in April of 1984.
From Roosevelt's days when he went to power, labor, and the cost of living, everything went up beautifully. A man could live and raise a family and buy a car and buy a home. This is the first generation we're going backwards. If you're over the age of 50, if you're over the age of 40, and you go to get a job, and they'll tell you you're too old to hire, and you're too young to retire, we have to put people back to work the jobs that they've had. that their fathers had, their grandfathers had, and these kids coming out of high school this summer, where are they going to go? They can't all fit in McDonald's and Burger King. We was expecting to leave these jobs to these kids.
Our ancestors built this country. They want an industrial, another industrial revolution. And if things keep going the way they are, and we end up with a two-tier society, the rich and the poor, tell you what, they're going to have more than they ever bargained for, because we'll give them all kind of problems.
Labor leaders, economists, all have their views on what lies ahead.
We say that there will be a shortfall of jobs due to technological change of 4 to 6 million jobs by 1990. Those are on top of normal frictional unemployment or cyclical unemployment. There'll be a mass of, we say, 4 to 6 million. U.S. News says 7.5 million people who'll be out of work because there'll be no jobs for them.
The concerns about technology and about structural change, in my judgment, are exaggerated because people don't distinguish between what's been caused by the recession and slow growth and what's genuinely caused by technology.
I think the central issue is not whether or not we want new technologies, whether or not we want robots or computers, because these are, in fact, extraordinary technologies in terms of bettering the society as far as their potential goes. I think the real issue is the social cost of the change. Who pays for it? How it's paid, in what time frame it's paid. And I think there is a real chance that certain unions will in fact become increasingly less cooperative with change if they perceive their members to be victims of the changes that are taking place.
In an industrial society today, only about 17% of the labor force are factory workers.
Harvard sociologist Daniel Bell wrote The Coming of Post-Industrial Society in 1973 and is currently writing The Third Technological Revolution.
Already 25%, one out of every four persons, a professional technical managerial. And we assume that simply the normal rates of change by the end of this decade, only 10% of the labor force will be factory workers.
If we live in this pretense that we can do away with that manufacturing industry and all of the Indonesians will produce our steel, or the Brazilians will produce our ships, or the Koreans will make our clothing, I don't know what we'll all be doing in this country. We'll all be unemployed is what we'll be doing.
We'll take a look at our biggest competitor, Japan, and how it is dealing with the third industrial revolution when CBS Reports continues. The rising sun of Japan sank after the military defeats of World War II and rose again on the economic battlefields of the post-war world. A society with a strong work ethic, disciplined, ambitious. Yet many Americans who remember the Japanese image from the old travel magazines still find it hard to believe. How could this country, with half the population of the United States, not much bigger in size than Montana, how could Japan do it? Today, the Japanese produce 15% of the free world's economic products. The modern Japanese who stream into their Tokyo offices can wear you out with sermons about high quality and high productivity. To this, they have added some showmanship and a love of gadgetry, as I found out when I visited a new plant and found that the receptionist was a robot.
Please input your reservation number on the keyboard in front of you.
But once past the metallic receptionist, the real purpose of the Japanese robot became evident.
At Japan's Yamazaki Machinery Works near Nagoya, a new plant was on the cutting edge of high tech. Here, 88 computer-controlled machine tools are linked to 34 robots. Together, they permit 215 men to produce as much as it would take 2,500 men to produce in a conventional plant.
What about the men replaced by machines? No problem, the plant manager told me. With high productivity, we find other jobs for them. This plant has it all: computers, CAD CAM, robots, and shuttle carts, many of them developed in the United States. American know-how plus Japanese initiative. The heart of the system here was a U.S. computer. As if to acknowledge that, American music blared all day on the factory floor. Glenn Miller with String of Pearls. States which developed robots and the Japanese who seized them. Their industrialists were delighted with robots, especially since there was a labor shortage in rapidly growing industries like autos. Today, the Japanese have 32,000 robots. The United States, 7,200. And the unions have not complained as long as no workers lost their jobs and any productivity benefits were shared by them.
I think they are far more mooted to make compromises with technology than our unions at home.
Frank Gibney, journalist and Encyclopedia Britannica executive, has written extensively about the Japanese.
Unions at home tend to be very simplistic about this, as nearly as I can see. They say, well, you want to lower the work week. The contract says this is the work week, and that's that period. The Japanese unions, of course, which, you know, are mostly enterprise unions, in the first place, always tend to think of themselves as part of the company. Now, they're not necessarily going to give in to management. They'll think that they can do better for the company than management can, but they always argue in the context of being part of the company.
Robots have been called steel-collar workers. They do jobs that are dull, dangerous, and dirty. One study estimates that 20 million industrial jobs around the world could be taken by robots, especially assembly line workers, machinists, painters, welders, and machine operators. A small percentage of those jobs will be absorbed by workers who will make and service those robots. In Japan, you see the process of phasing in and phasing out side by side. At Hitachi, a robot installs belts in a videotape recorder. Right next to it, a worker doing the same repetitive job. The robot will soon move down the line and replace her, and she'll be retrained for something else. Retraining, finding other jobs for workers, is part of the much-advertised Japanese commitment to lifetime employment.
It's maybe commitment, in your expression, can be commitment, but in Japanese expression could be understanding, because we do have an understanding when you are working for a certain company that you are hoping to be employed for your lifetime, and of course it's not in a paper, not in a contract, but it's an understanding.
With Japanese being shifted into new jobs as automation and robots take their old ones, the opportunities for the young entering the job market have been narrowed. Still, the unemployment rate holds at under 3%.
Many people think of the Japanese success in terms of the corporate style, which is true for particular corporations. But for the economy as a whole, their strategy has been essentially to go what they call knowledge-intensive industries and high value added, which is basically the application of human capital. Now, once we begin to think of human capital, we've got a very different conception of a resource and a very different conception of investment.
At the foot of Mount Fuji is Fanuc Limited, called the factory of the future, unlike any in the world and rivaling the visions of science fiction. Here, robots make robots and other tools. During the day, 90 workers are on the machining floor. At 5:30, they leave, but the plant keeps working through the night, the robots moving parts into the machines, shuttle carts loading and unloading in the eerie darkness. The plant costs $32 million and is five times as productive as its conventional counterpart. A controller monitors the entire operation on closed-circuit TV in another building. If this is the factory of the future, it will sound like this. It will lack one dimension, the human voice. Fanuc makes the GMF robot, a joint venture with General Motors, which plans to spend $1 billion to install 20,000 robots by 1990. The first robots were primitive, pick up and put down. They're not yet as sophisticated as R2-D2, but they're getting there. This experimental robot at Hitachi can maneuver with almost the dexterity of the human arm. And smart robots are coming online. Robots that can see with TV cameras and laser beams, can sense light, dark, color, shape, and temperature. This smart robot is assembling parts in a videotape recorder. It recognizes the different shapes and knows precisely where to put them.
I think they're just fascinated by technology per se, and they think of eras, as they call them, like the post-industrial revolution or the information revolution, far in advance of the moment when they activate them. But they like to think in these terms. In a sense, it's become a national hobby.
Japan is spending millions in the race for supremacy in supercomputers. These computers are the most powerful available and have significant military and scientific applications. Present models, like this one at Bell Laboratories in New Jersey, produce 150 million arithmetic operations a second. The next generation may produce 10 billion. It's been said that the nation with the best supercomputer has the key to world leadership in the 21st century.
It took us 7 years to generate a new generation of machines. The Japanese did it in 3 years. Now, they got a lot of that information in the free, open literature, which is, of course, very healthy. The real test of the Japanese will come for the next generation of machines. Will they be able to build the biggest, most innovative machines themselves without getting free information from us?
Not all free. Of course, you see the ubiquitous Japanese with their cameras and sketch pads at all the trade shows. But everyone does that. In 1982, however, two of Japan's most prestigious computer makers were charged with stealing secrets from IBM after an FBI sting operation. When IBM sued, one of them, Hitachi, agreed to a heavy settlement. Overseas competition has intensified, but two aspects have become nightmares for American workers. The first is when their own companies move offshore, as here, across the border in Mexico, where cheap labor is plentiful and readily learns the skills.
It's a simple matter of economics. The stockholders in these companies are indifferent to where the profit comes from. Their main concern is that firms make profits. And you could say, well, let's just have loyal American firms employing Americans. But the problem here is that they're competing, of course, with firms in other countries who are also exploiting those third world labor pools.
The second nightmare, American workers say, is when they're competing not against a foreign company, but a foreign country. How about a steel mill that can ship coal all the way to South Korea from mines it partially owns in West Virginia and Pennsylvania? Use that coal to make steel and ship the steel back to us for less than we can make it for. They mean Pohang Iron and Steel near Busan, heavily subsidized by the government and one of the most efficient mills in the world. In South Korea, steel workers in 1983 averaged about $2 an hour, compared with Japan's $11 and U.S.'s $21, including benefits. Pohang's 15,000 workers also get subsidized housing, schools, and recreation near the 2,200-acre complex. South Korea provides 10% of all U.S. steel imports. Even the Japanese who helped develop the plant are worried, have reportedly barred Pohang engineers from their mills, saying, "We're selling the Koreans tools to bury us." What happened to this South Korean steel when it reached one city in the United States, when CBS Reports continues. Once at the center of America's growth, steel was the very simple, the backbone of the nation's industrial strength. Today, steel is more likely to evoke images of weakness and rust. At its peak, the United States produced half of the world's steel. Today, the United States imports a quarter of what it needs. Whether rising imports are the cause or the consequence of America's steel's decline, the impact is not in dispute. When plans for a multi-million dollar office building were announced in Seattle, Isaacson Steel, a small fabricating plant less than 5 miles from the construction site, seemed an odds-on favorite to win the steel contract. But proximity and one of the lowest bids wasn't quite enough for the already financially troubled Isaacson. The contract went instead to U.S. Steel, which, in a move that was to anger the already disappointed Isaacson workers, announced they would buy their steel in Japan and have it fabricated in Korea.
When foreign companies can take and come in and undersell us, and we're just only a few miles away, well, I think this is there's something radically wrong.
What was radically wrong for Isaacson was that it couldn't hope to match either the low wages or low prices of a government-subsidized competitor 10,000 miles away. Shortly after construction on the building began, Isaacson closed its plant, putting its 270 iron workers either into early retirement or the Seattle job lines. And in a final act of irony that did not escape the laid-off workers, the plant's equipment was sold to the People's Republic of China.
It's going to come back to us, and we're going to pay for it.
You know, I don't understand what the heck's happening. I understand it, but I hate to see it. Like I say, shoes, you can't do that. I defy people to take off their shoes, their jackets, whatever, and find them made in this country.
I think we have to step back and reassess our values here, and I think we have to look at what made this country great in the first place. And I really believe that it's the working man, the blue collar guy, the hands-on man. You know, I think we all five of us here have got dirty and beat our brains out, but I think we did it with a purpose. And I think the purpose was that I'm not a flag waver by any means, but I think that it's very important to all of us, you know, what our country means to us. And, you know, we give them 8 for 8. You know, we give them 8 hours work for 8 hours pay.
To compete on a one-to-one basis, you'd have to roll back the wages to medieval times. Do we give up our standard of living that we've worked so hard for in this country because the rest of the world's starting to catch up with us, technology-wise, but not living-wise?
Some feel the steel workers have brought this upon themselves, that their wage demands over the years helped bring about their own unemployment. That, most industry experts feel, is too simplistic a shift of blame.
There's this anti-union sentiment in the country. I don't know why, because nobody's against people who work hard making a decent wage and having their kids go to college and being able to pay for it instead of getting a student loan and being able to buy a car and not have it repossessed or being able to buy a house. But some, they're oversimplifying all of this. People keep yelling at me saying, you're paying too much. And I say, what do you want me to do? Turn back the clock 50 years. But the question is the right one. But over time, won't we have to make some adjustments? Yes, everybody wants somebody else to make an adjustment, though. He doesn't want to cut his pay in half.
Cutting wages is rarely an option available to any industry, and cutting imports might not have the desired effect either.
Quotas are the worst form of protection. They're much worse, in my judgment, even than tariffs. Because what they do is they literally freeze the number of imports that could come into the country. And what that means is, from the point of view that now the domestic industry finds that its monopoly is strengthened. The domestic industry can raise its prices. In fact, what is happening is when we put quotas on some of our industries, it actually destroys jobs.
As the United States moves from being an industrial society to a technological society, the burden of this transition seems to fall heaviest on certain segments of the population. In America's Rust Bowl, where steel mills once helped millions of blue-collar workers become middle-class in purchasing power, there seems to be no plan for transition, no way of halting a trend that some experts say began in the 70s.
What we've seen
in America in the 70s, and we're seeing it continue in the 80s, is that factories are being picked up and moved to other parts of the world. We're seeing firms like U.S. Steel take their capital and move it out of steel to buy up companies like Marathon Oil. And the result of all that capital mobility has been the destruction of our communities.
Many of those who lost their jobs in the 70s to plant closings and relocations were in the smokestack cities. But unemployment isn't just the story of Youngstown or Detroit.
The story of unemployment is not, by and large, a story of displaced steel workers or automobile workers. At the bottom of the recession, unemployed steel workers and automobile workers accounted for 5% of the total unemployed. So that 95% of the people who were out of jobs were not steel and auto workers. So there is indeed dislocation as a result of what is happening in those sectors. But the real question is that broadly representative of what is happening in American manufacturing in general or in the American economy overall?
In a sense, the unemployed auto worker and the unemployed steel worker are increasingly becoming forgotten. We're focusing on those aggregate figures that show unemployment coming down from record highs. And all of a sudden we see, well, maybe the economy is performing well. Maybe we're in a recovery. But for places like Cleveland and Detroit and Youngstown, it's hardly a recovery. It's what I think might aptly be termed manufacturing Appalachias.
Let's look at the people who have lost their jobs. They're in one place, but people have gained jobs in another area. And when I said that robots don't displace people, that's not true. They do displace people, but other jobs were created meanwhile. And that's the significant thing.
It's also the problem. As many communities in the Rust Bowl become virtual ghost towns, their jobless citizens are not likely to take comfort in knowing their jobs have helped the new boom towns like Silicon Valley increase employment by 156% since the 1960s, three times the national average. High tech is expected to create a number of new jobs by the 1990s, but not many of them will go to the blue-collar workers displaced in manufacturing. High tech tends to be for the younger, just beginning worker. And even high tech won't be leading the help wanted list. It will be far down among tomorrow's available jobs. Secretaries, hospital workers, and fast food help will be on top.
Okay!
Which still leaves large numbers of blue collar workers with the wrong skills.
The answer is in retraining, and here I think we need a massive effort on the part of government and labor and management. I would start any industrial policy with saying you displace lots of people. You have to retrain them.
The amount of money that is spent on training is a mere fraction of the amount that should be spent. And we have a very narrow view of training in this country, unlike most Western European countries. Our view of training here is giving someone the ability to learn new skills. But what about the infrastructure? What about the financial support that's necessary for a 45-year-old auto worker to move into a new job, perhaps even in a different area of the country?
Critics say that there is only one federal program specifically for retraining displaced workers and no central authority or clearinghouse that will help blue-collar workers find new skills or new jobs. Neither government or industry was prepared for this transition in our workforce.
The difficulty is that we seem to be moving in a direction where as industry becomes more productive and you need fewer and fewer workers to produce physical goods, we're becoming more of a service society. But we're becoming a service society with a few good jobs at one extreme and lots of jobs that only pay minimum wage at the other extreme. And if we become the kind of service society where the service jobs are fast food jobs, janitor's jobs, typist jobs, nursing home aid jobs, those are jobs that pay $3.50, $4 an hour. They're not the kind of jobs that pay enough money to support a middle-class standard of living.
Doesn't that concern you that our entire wage scale is going to come down and we're going to lower our standard of living?
It worries the hell out of me. Are we going to be a second-class nation? Are we going to lower our standards, our sights? Are we going to be able to buy a house or car in the future? I don't buy the line that everybody's going to adjust to that. And we shouldn't have that as a goal.
We're actually asking the American people in the 1980s to live with considerably less than they ever expected they would get. What we're going to find in the economy as we divide into a high-wage, high-skill sector and a low-wage, low-skill sector, is that a lot of the glue that holds a society together, the social glue of equal opportunity, the social glue of being able to improve one's life chances, is going to disappear. And with that, one can expect that you're going to get all kinds of political and social stresses. And I can't believe that people don't think that there's a better way.
That sounds like a rerun of the Industrial Revolution. Technical advancement leading to social disruption with its economic fallout, the growth of the militant trade union movement, and its political repercussions, new formulas to divide the wealth like Marxism and socialism. A look at the 1990s and beyond when CBS Reports continues. Traditionally, unions in the United States have resisted automation on the grounds it threatened jobs. But in a somewhat surprising turnabout, 8,000 General Electric employees in Lynn, Massachusetts, recently voted overwhelmingly in favor of letting robots and high-tech into their factory. Critics of the plan charged General Electric with using a stick-and-carrot approach, threatening to take the automation and the jobs elsewhere. But the majority of workers seemed to feel a trade-off was in order. While no jobs will be lost or added in GE's new automated aircraft engine plant, the workers did have to agree to new work rules and 12-hour shifts.
The way some of us view this in the local union is that this was our opportunity to enter the 21st century. We could have sat at our anvils with our mallets, I suppose, plodded along while the investments went elsewhere, but we thought that this was definitely worth a shot and see it as a big step into the future, which we want to be a part of.
There is the concern about technology and where we're going with it. You know, I think there still is this lingering fear that technology ultimately is going to put a hell of a lot of people out of work. Our experience in the engine business is that if you don't have technology, if you don't push it as fast as you can, you grow less competitive and you lose business. So to us, you know, and we've proven this over 40 years in this business, you embrace technology, you push it for all it's worth.
As more and more industries turn to robots and high tech to increase productivity and profits, the position of the factory worker again becomes proportionately more vulnerable.
It's difficult to assign a value of robots. We always say they do come to work every Monday and Friday, and they're never late, and they are accurate. You program them, and they do the same repetitive operation every day the same way. They're never going to replace all workers. People ask me the question, how many have been replaced to date? I don't know. We've gone absolutely crazy on the installation of robots and CAD-CAM, computer work for design, and obviously have replaced some people. To get productive and to get quality, you need high technology. But you don't do it without people.
For those industries that will do it without people, the problem again will be the displaced worker. Some economists and experts think a solution might be to shorten the work week, share the jobs around.
Why does a job have to be so many hours a week? What's wrong with flex time for everybody?
We started at 80 hours a week and went to 72 and 16, 48 and 40. But the last time we moved is almost 50 years ago. We've had a standard 40-hour work week for, well, between 40 and 50 years in this country. And we haven't made the slightest change in that time, except perhaps to lengthen vacations slightly. It seems to me that we're well ready for another movement, whether it's to 35 or 32 or 30 hours, as the normal work week for people.
What would you do with your time if you didn't work 40 hours a week? I work 60 and I can't even get to 50 or 40. But I never see people saying I'd like to be in a 3 or 4 day week and just become a bum or I should say it differently, use my leisure time. You get tired if you had 4 days a week off. I think the work ethic is in all of us in this country in our own way. And we want a good job and we want to have leisure time. But I think you're going to have 40 hour weeks as far as I can see. I can't see anything that would radically change that.
I think some fresh thinking is called for. For the long run, I believe that we're going to have to shorten the work week. We're going to have to come up with all kinds of inventions to spread around the available work. I mean, professors get sabbaticals. Why can't everybody get a sabbatical once every 7 years, or a subsidized retraining sabbatical, where as the work that you've been doing becomes sidelined by new technological advances, you go back to school for 6 months?
Sharing the work around, taking sabbaticals, reducing the work week without reducing earnings are some of the glamour options open to us. And there are others, like a return to cottage industry, people working at home. More than 5 million Americans do so today, and high tech, as we shall see, will increase that number sharply. Traditional cottage industry, fine crafts, fine furniture, an alternative to the plastic in our lives, may solve some of our unemployment problems, may also find millions moving to rural America, changing our patterns of family life, devitalizing the great urban centers. The movement already has begun. When he left the city, Dan Mosheim put his blue-collar skill to work in the Vermont countryside.
There's a revival in the craft world. People are becoming more aware that things that are handmade in general have a certain appeal that factory or mass-produced items don't. And there really are getting to be more and more people making a living this way. And as a result, the interaction between these people, the things that they produce are getting nicer and nicer and of a higher and higher quality.
And there's a new kind of cottage industry, high tech. It centers on the computer. Americans are buying them at the rate of 6 million a year. By the turn of the century, they'll be as common a household fixture as a television set is today. From her suburban Massachusetts living room, Gretchen Marx puts in her own version of the 8-hour day, providing a secretarial service for bosses she sometimes never sees. By 1990, it's predicted that 15 million people will be working with computers at home, confirming, I suppose, a high-tech adage, you don't have to commute to compute.
Are you ready? Okay, found this.
With his portable, Steve Roberts, a computer consultant and freelance writer, can hook into an information bank or send copy to an editor wherever he finds a telephone. Labor leaders see this revival differently, fearing a return to the sweatshops of another industrial revolution. They've gone to court to prevent certain kinds of manufacturing in the home. Cottage industry workers vow to have any such laws changed. Other laws may have to be changed as well. Laws to help compensate or relocate the millions who don't have a skill or the aptitude to make a living at home. As high-tech and shifting manufacturing needs diminish the economic opportunities of more and more people, a national safety net of new laws may be their only hope.
Are you satisfied that enough planning is being done by industry and government?
Oh, no. I think it's a crime. I go to Washington a lot and tell them the United States is missing a strategic plan. And that's sad. We have a strategic plan in the Defense Department for 5 years to spend $300 billion a year, but we don't have a strategic plan to get people working to get the revenues, and this gets into this deficit talk and the like. So I think that we are ill-equipped today. We've talked it to death, but we have not really attacked the problem moving into the high-technology world.
If we're going to solve the deindustrialization problem and put people back to work in this country, we're going to need, among other things, a major federal commitment to re-industrializing industries like auto, steel, and tires, and also a major federal commitment to retraining, to migration allowances, to new educational programs to train the next generation of workers for the new jobs that exist. Without a massive federal commitment to that task, America is going to be in big trouble.
We've got a tremendous, to me, policy problem. Strategic planning problem that is caught up now in the buzzwords of industrial policy that most people have an anathema toward that. It sounds like central planning. It isn't. It's to try to answer your question in some depth. What kind of a country do we want to be? I don't have all the answers, but I got a lot of good questions to ask down in Washington.
What does your pragmatic mind tell you life is going to be like in the United States in the year 2010, say?
I honestly think that it could go either way. I mean, here we are in Boston, and I look out over the city, and I see lots of new shopping malls, luxury, super upscale shopping malls, and I go into those downtown malls, and I see these very expensive new stores, gold-plated merchandise, and I wonder who in the devil has the purchasing power, the discretionary income, as economists say, to buy all that stuff. And then I look on the other side of the counter, and I see people making $4 or $5 an hour, waiting on the people who are spending $150 for a shirt. And I see jobs being generated as chambermaids, and I see jobs being generated parking the cars. And I worry very much about what the future of this country is as a middle-class society.
And that new middle class is now entering the workplace, where much is promised, but few things assured. Most are better educated than the workers they replace, but not all will get jobs that require a college degree. None probably will ever work in a steel mill, but they won't all have jobs with computers either. Being middle class for some will mean having to hold two jobs, while others may only work 20 hours a week. But what of their replacements? These workers of the 1990s came to terms with the high-tech revolution before they'd even had a chance to study the American Revolution. For them, the future means choice, not change. Others less fortunate, with few computers in their schools and none at home, will end up with the largest portion of the employment pie, but the one with the lowest paying jobs. The challenge that lies ahead for the politicians, for the sociologists, for the labor and industrial leaders, is to find ways to make the new technologies work so that workers and industries can adapt, so that smokestack cities can be rebuilt, so that Americans will be the beneficiaries and not the victims of the third industrial revolution. This is Walter Cronkite for CBS Reports.
They were only children, abandoned and left to survive on their own. Chris Sarandon and Melissa Michelson star in Broken Promise, next following Newsbreak.